What's the best investment strategy in a period of market extremes? Well, we have seasoned pros from different disciplines to advise us today. Our first guest is the highly regarded chief market analyst at Merrill Lynch. She is Mary Ann Bartels, who brings over 20 years of investment experience as a technical analyst, strategist, and portfolio manager. And stocks are not the only asset class exhibiting extreme behavior. Bonds and treasury bonds in particular are the expertise of our next guest. Robert Kessler and his firm Kessler Investment Advisors run bond portfolios for institutional investors and governments all over the world. Then there is Russia. Our next guest is Russia specialist John Connor. He is the founder and portfolio manager of the Third Millennium Russia Fund, which has delivered impressive 30% annualized returns over the past 5 years. Connor's new book, Out of the Red, Investment and Capitalism in Russia, has just been published. So welcome to all of you. Great to have you here.
Thank you.
Thanks for being on WealthTrack. Mary Ann, as we survey the nearly universal carnage in the markets that occurred this week, what is your assessment of the stock market's condition? And especially, I'm thinking about those of us who own index funds.
Well, Consuelo, obviously we're in a market correction, but to put this into perspective, we had a great bull market from 02 to 07, and the market gained nearly, well, it was just over 100%. And markets don't go up forever. We do have periods, and they normally average every 4 years, where we get a pullback or a correction within the market. That's what I think we're in right now. So it's a little bit of a tough going, but we think some very good value is actually developing in the market. Now, when we look at the market, though, the leadership is still intact, and that's why I'm still very bullish on the market longer term, is we still have leadership. Leadership, in our view, are the commodity complex. You have energy and materials that benefit from the commodities. What we're having troubles with, obviously, are the financials, and because the consumer is under pressure, the consumer part of the market, which we call consumer discretionary stocks, are also under pressure. But we think there's a little bit more downside to the market. Our indicators tell us that we're coming very close to a very good buying opportunity. That pessimism index is really starting to signal for us. But to give a downside target, maybe we have another 6 to 8%, but we think
in the S&P,
within the S&P, okay, the Dow, we think there's about 6 to 8% more downside, but we think this is going to open up some good opportunity in certain areas of the market.
You know, Robert Kessler, one of the performance standouts over the last year has been Treasury bonds. You have told us this on WealthTrack many, many times. There are been a lot of doubters out there. You know, I think that the 10-year has returned better than 15% versus double-digit losses over the last year. So, you know, even corporate bonds have held their value. You know, why is it? Why do you think Treasury bonds especially have held their value?
This is a unique kind of a market because it's the first time we're seeing it being led by the consumers. It may be that the downside of the market, and the slowdown is being caused by the consumers. So when you have a whole lending facility, the credit market, as we call it, the credit market, that's literally being bailed out. It's being funded by almost the United States government. Right now, our major banks are being funded in a way they've never been funded before, and our investment banks are being funded in a way they've never been funded before.
Right, by the Fed, the discount window.
By the discount window. In a marketplace like this, where for the first time we see it slowing down, we don't have a clue as to what the consumer is going to look like in 6 months, it becomes like a slow train wreck or a slow motion process that gets worse and worse and worse. And from an optimistic viewpoint, you want it to end, you want it to be a V, but it's turning out to be more of this L. It gets down and then keeps going down, and then probably will take an awful long time to regenerate the kind of buying power that we need in this country to make it work.
Okay. You know, John Connor, I mean, Russia has been one of the standout markets. No longer. It too has, you know, fallen with the other markets. And recently, and in your fund, which was the number two emerging market fund at the end of the second quarter, is still, you know, is still considered to be one of the best emerging market funds, but it's been a really tough slog for you recently too. Is this just part of the broad global sell-off, or is there something else going on in Russia? Is this anything unique to Russia?
Well, I would take Russia as a proxy for the BRIC countries, for example. I won't say it's totally decoupled, but I think if this is the first time when these countries may be helping to bail out, as it were, the U.S. with all its subprime and other problems, because there's this continuing demand, and this is the question: is it a commodity bubble, or will the commodities continue to sell in South and East Asia and China and India? Fertilizers, for example, are my best performing sector, and the fertilizer baron just bought Donald Trump's home down there in Palm Beach, so there's an example. But the point is, Russia is almost decoupled from the U.S. in practical terms. There's almost no direct business, which is one reason why it's easy to kick Russia, and everybody kicks Russia all the time. But the markets are somewhat related, it's true, but the question is, will these BRIC countries, these stronger emerging markets, the rest of the world, so to speak, will they be at a plus? I think so, and I think demand will continue because their homes and cars and automobiles, Russia's the biggest auto market in Europe now. There's just an underserved market, unpenetrated markets, consumer demand. It's a consumer economy, and I think it's not that different from Brazil, China, and India.